It's 10:05. It's mornings with me, Connie McLaughlin. How you doing? Thank you so much, by the way, to everyone who got in touch with us about a really emotive, a really difficult conversation that we were having about dementia there. So many of you getting in touch. Thanks to Ken for texting in. Both my elderly parents suffered from dementia and had to move into a nursing home once care in the community couldn't cope any longer and support them. My mum died in 2020, my father in 2022. Sadly, my sister, aged 63 now, has early onset dementia and has recently had to move into a nursing home. I think what Ken's saying is both my parents' sisters' houses had to be sold in order to pay for their care. At present, my sister is having to pay £6,000 per month to pay for her care. That's a part of this that we didn't even really have time to touch too much on, but that's a huge part of this as well. I think a couple of our callers had mentioned it in passing, but listen, it's a really difficult subject. 80295. Keep your thoughts on that coming in. I'll try and pepper them throughout the show, but I really appreciate everyone who got in touch. And remember that action line as well, bbc.co.uk/actionline, if you want some more information and help. Still to come this morning.
In London at the end of August, there is no other number to call. At the moment, there is only 999 that relatives can call when someone's in that crisis, and that's not going to change between now and the 30th of August.
After the police in London say they will no longer attend mental health emergencies, who is the right person if not the police? I suppose that ties in a little bit in some way to some of the callers that we had earlier on as well, and who deals with that? It's an awful lot of people need an awful lot of help, but who provides that help? Also this morning,
I guess I should introduce ourselves, seeing as no one actually knows who we are. We're called Royal Blood, and this is rock music. Who likes rock music?
Oh, cringe. If you've seen this video, you might have been cringing too. The band Royal Blood didn't get on too well with the crowd at Radio 1's big weekend in Dundee. We're going to be speaking to singer Horse McDonald and comedian Susie McCabe about trying to win over crowds and when is it okay to have a little bit of a huff. And also, we're going to be speaking a little bit later about how you end decade-long feuds. Is it possible? Let me know.
All the conversations that matter.
Mornings on BBC Radio Scotland.
We've also got the coach of Karen a little bit later as well. She will be here with me in the studio talking about her latest dilemma. So you can stick around if you can for that. She's going to be with me later on this morning. And also, we're talking about this feud thing, and it's to do with Sir Alex Ferguson and Roy Keane. They used to be great pals, and their feud, which started many years ago, is still ongoing. So is there a way that after a really long period of time, you can become pals with someone again? We'll talk more about that. This is
Dumbs bust the scientifical approach to the course, and the force is centrifugal. Can you find your way through the lyrics that be catching them? Throw another rhyme across the room, they be fetching them. And they take a loss to the master. And I throw those crazy blows, and they knows I be plastering all across the room, on the ceilings and the walls too. Punk little suckers didn't know I had the gall to come around they block with my cock diesel system and turn it up to 10 and then start to diss them. And they didn't want to battle if they did when they saw me. They'd have opened up their trunk, but they tried to ignore me. Hey little suckers, I know you hear me calling you, but you wanted some, but I see that you're all into frontin'. Ain't no future in your frontin', so let's get it on like Marvin Gaye. Take the cash and sit it on the hood of your wick whack low riding Cadillac. Back up your boys and let's start the battle act like, you know, the master ace. Don't play when it comes to my bass.
Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby.
I was born wrong.
The block, like what else should a brother do? It's Saturday, the heat might smother you. Rolling down my windows, yeah, I have an air conditioner, but I got the sound I want the whole world to listen to. Waiting at a red light, Kentucky Fried Chicken, and blowing
Jerry taping, bass crazy kicking it. See this Puerto Rican Latin Chico Rico Suave in the red Corolla. Ayo, does he wanna play? Pulling up beside me, looking like he want it. Show me what you got, then watch me get up on it. Holding up traffic, but we can't hear they horns, cause he got music a grande, yeah, he got it going on. But I think I better school him, cause he don't know the time. So I'm turning up the boom, cause he cannot mess with mine. Brothers hit me hitting from like 50 blocks away. I wanna turn the heads so you know I got to play. High decibels passing through a residential district. See a few cuties and I turn it up like this quick. Mira, mira, man, don't sleep. I got the woofers in my Jeep.
Check it out, baby, check it out, dog. Check it out, baby, check it out, dog. Check it out, baby, check it out, dog. Check it out, baby,
I was born to roll.
Check it out, baby, check it out, dog. Check it out, baby, check it out, dog. Check it out, baby, check it out, dog. Check it out, baby,
I was born to roll.
Black boy, turn that ish down. You know that America don't wanna hear the sound of the bass drum. Jungle music, go back to Africa. I guess I'll arrest ya if you're holding up traffic. I'll be damned if I listen, so cops save your breath and write another ticket if you have any left. I'm breaking eardrums while I'm breaking the law. I'm disturbing all the peace cause sister soldier said war. So catch me if you can, here's a donut. Cause once you drive away, yo, you know I'm gonna go nut. And turn it up the way it was before, nice try. But you can't stop the power of the bass in your eye. I wonder if I blasted a little Elvis Presley, would they pull me over and attempt to arrest me? I really doubt it. They probably start dancing, jumping on my tippin', pissing in they pants and wiggling and jiggling and grabbing on their pelvis. But you know my name, so you never hear no Elvis. Strictly the hardcore, dirty street level hits. Guards on my side, so watch what the devil gets. Positivity hitting 50 levels deep. Coming out the woofers in my Jeep.
Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby.
I was born to roll.
Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby. Check it out, dog. Check it out, baby.
I was born to roll.
It is 12 minutes after 10. Did you see this, maybe on social media or at some point over the weekend? The band Royal Blood's frontman was facing a lot of criticism after his reaction to Radio 1's Big Weekend in Dundee. The crowd and him didn't really quite get on as well as they might have.
Well, I guess I should introduce ourselves, seeing as no one actually knows who we are. We're called Royal Blood and this is rock music. Who likes rock music? 9 people, brilliant. This is Ben Thatcher, he plays drums. Everybody say hi to Ben, please. We're having to clap ourselves because that was so pathetic. Well done, Ben. Can you clap for us? Can you clap? You're busy. Can you clap? He's busy. Yes, even he's clapping. What does that say about you?
Right, at the end, I think what he was doing there, he was saying to someone, can you clap as well? I think he was actually talking to the cameraman because he was basically trying to make out that no one else was clapping. So the cameraman that was filming him, he was trying to say, can you clap too? And after the set, the frontman, Mike Kerr, that's who was speaking, he walked off stage giving the two-finger salute, you know the one I mean, to the audience, the rude one, by the way. So we're asking this morning, why do adults sometimes decide that it's okay to have a bit of a temper tantrum? And what's behind that reaction? What is it also like to be on stage when you've not won over a crowd? Here to tell us more about that is Horse McDonald, singer and songwriter. Morning, Horse.
Good morning.
We've also got Susie McCabe, who's a comedian, of course, we know. Morning, Susie.
Good morning.
And Emma Kenny, psychologist and friend of the show. Morning, Emma.
Good morning.
Right, okay. Let's get right down to it, everyone, right? Let's just nobody take the huff if I don't come to you first, right? Because, I've watched this, Horse, I've watched this a couple of times, yeah. And I don't really know where he's coming from because actually I thought the crowd's reaction was okay. I'm like, is this something that he's planned to, and it's kind of backfired or what is going on?
I think he probably had a stroke before he went on the stage and it continued when he got out there. At the end of the day, the agent made a terrible mistake and it was about money, maybe, about what was happening. They were on in between Niall Horan and Lewis Capaldi.
Not easy.
You know, that's a Radio 1 crowd. I myself, believe it or not, have not really had many strops, but if I have a strop, it won't be in front of my audience. And if it's not my audience, I want to win the audience over. It's a really, it's a legendary, normal process of performing on any stage. I'm sure Susie would agree. You know, you basically, you work your audience. We toured with Tina Turner. We were playing to 10,000 people every night who were shouting, Tina, Tina. Yeah. And I'm like, okay, here we go, you know, into the lion's den. But you want to win the audience over. And I don't understand that kind of rock god mentality. If you're at Reading, it's different, you know. But he called the crowd pathetic. I mean, that's inciting a riot, I would suggest.
I don't really understand it either, Susie. So I suppose a wee bit more context. As Horst is saying, they were in between Niall Horan and Lewis Capaldi. I think there was a bit of a last-minute change to the billing for different reasons, so they were kind of put in there. Normally, you would think in that situation, this is my chance. That's quite high up the billing on a really big weekend where there's an awful lot of people that are watching and listening to this. This is your chance to go and say, right, okay, let's make some headlines for the right reasons, not for these ones.
Yeah, totally. Like I think it's an opportunity. You know, whenever you go out on a stage, especially in comedy, especially when you start, you're doing gigs. You're not doing, you know, a load of solo shows and stuff like that. You're doing gigs with other comedians, and you can be the 10th spot. But you want to just go out and do really well that people then maybe add you in social media and then they do come and see you at a solo show. Last year, I got to support Kevin Bridges over 20 dates in Scotland. Now, no one is there to see me. No one. My name is not in the door, but I knew that I had an opportunity to play to 12,000 people in Glasgow every night for 10, 15 minutes, let them see me and go, I'm going to look out for her and buy a ticket. And it absolutely worked. I got audiences from that. So you see it as your opportunity and go and just go and take it. Just go and take your opportunity. Leave your own ego at the door and just go and enjoy the experience. Because I've heard of Niall Horan. I've heard of Lewis Capaldi. I have never heard of this band until this happened. So that's then a thing where you go, people are there, some people will see you and really like you, some people won't like you, but just accept that no one has actually bought a ticket to specifically see you and go and use it as a platform.
Well,
I would say you have to know your place because... Yeah. You're entitled because you get caught out in front of an audience, especially teenagers. You know, you'll soon get caught out. Every audience is definitely a challenge, but yeah, do you know what I would suggest? People go and look at Aidan Moffat or Catherine Williams' thread about this. It's fantastic. We're all just basically saying the same thing. You know, get out there. Work the crowd. If you're going to have a strop, have it elsewhere. But these are the people that don't bite the hand that feeds you. These are the people that maybe you win over.
Here's the other side to this, though, and I cannot wait to get Emma's take on this. I can't wait to get Emma's take on actually what's going on in somebody's mind about this, right? But maybe the flip side to that, and Susie hit the nail on the head, potentially, because you said, I've heard of Niall, I've heard of Lewis Capaldi. Now we're talking about Royal Blood. So there's that thing about, is this someone, was this a little bit premeditated of someone sitting at a desk thinking, oh, I know what a good idea is because we're going to get a wee bit of social media traction with this. And it's, yes. And it's in some way, I don't know, you know, the whole good, any press is there's no such thing as bad press. I don't
think that always works. Because
exactly.
I think
yeah.
You come across as so entitled that you have to, You have to, it's like Horst said, you have to know your place. And it, you know, it's so important in the arts as well, because you're going through a learning curve until you become headliner or whatever. Then you're going through another learning curve and you're doing all that stuff. See, at the end of the day, like, I was fortunate enough to host Edinburgh's Hugmanay this year, and the Pet Shop Boys were headlining, and there was a DJ on first. So I went out and I done my crowd control, done all the advice and all that. And then when I went back out after the DJ prior to the Pet Shop Boys, I said to 10,000 people in the gardens and 40,000, 50,000 people in Princes Street, now is your time to use the facilities, get your drinks, do everything that you want to do before the headline act, because I'm going to be here for 20 minutes and you're not here for me, you're here for the headline act. So go and do everything that you want to do
right.
so that when the headline act comes on, you can just enjoy it.
Emma.
And that's what you have to do. You just have to accept that that's your job and that's a great job. See the fact that you get to go on a stage and come home and pay your bills with the money that you've earned, that is the best thing in the world. And if you're going to drop off stages, you don't deserve those stages.
Right, Emma, I think it might have been, I think it was Susie there who mentioned that word ego. What's at play here? Give us your expert opinion on what's going on from what you know, because it's obviously hard to say without chatting to them, but...
No, but I mean, like, I think everybody's said the things that are actually correct because of the fact that you use the word entitlement and you use the word like disrespect and the fact that there is a certain etiquette that you're expected to have and show when you're working with a crowd. But I guess that there are a few things that interplay here. First of all, if they were having a bad day. Secondly, if the permission base between the band is this crowd aren't going to appreciate us, so therefore that incites the amplification of those negative feelings. Mm-hmm. If they don't instantly get a reaction when they go on stage, when they're trying to be humorful, therefore they feeling immediately abandoned. And then the consequence of that is instead of just knowing your place and recognising that the worst thing you can do is get a viral post where you look like idiots or you look really childish, that's the other thing. And then you dare to bring in the words rock and roll, because the thing about rock and roll bands is they are naughty and they do behave badly in certain situations, but it's not against the fans.
Precisely.
And the expectation that everybody's going to love you is a false expectation. You know, if 20% of a crowd love you, well, that's fantastic at a festival. But I just think meltdowns, they happen more likely and more readily when you've got other people who will kind of agree with you. And he did, because obviously the band themselves were feeling that way and they responded by supporting one another and acting really intolerable and childish in that moment.
Because we think that that this is something that is, probably most of us know that it's not, but something that's just, you know, that we expect to see from children. But
yes.
It's interesting what you said there about, you know, they might have felt abandoned. They might have felt that there's something coming
yes.
to the surface there that I mean it's all good chat for us to say, oh, they were childish, whatever, but we don't really know. There's something playing out there quite evidently that for all to see, that maybe that person now waking up today might be a bit regretful and might be thinking, oh my goodness, I've now gone
sure.
viral, I'm so embarrassed.
Yeah, I don't think it's necessarily embarrassment.
It's not in their Twitter feed. There's nothing in their social media at all about this. Nothing. So I don't know if that says something about they've been told to keep quiet or they're just leaving it as is.
Yeah.
Can I just to say there was a situation you're talking about, did they plan it? I don't think they did plan it. Jarvis Cocker never planned to jump up on that stage of Michael Jackson, but it destroyed his mental health for a good 5-6 years after that, if you read about that. So I think, I don't think it was planned.
I think this is something, Emma, as well, that we need to remember. Because as much as, you know, it's that age-old adage, isn't it? But if you put yourself out there, you put yourself on that stage, then you have to take the consequences of things that come alongside it, blah, blah, blah. We all know how right or wrong that might be in terms of that as an opinion or a way to look at it. But these are human beings as well. And I suppose, what's this telling us?
I mean, I think that what you're saying is correct. Somebody in a situation where they make a mistake, albeit a public mistake, that shouldn't define them. It's crazy the way the world is at the moment. You can have a career that's astonishingly successful and then you'll do one thing and the world hates you and you are completely rejected. And the reality is that's a terrible mindset. It's terrible to teach our children that you can't sometimes make mistakes.
Yeah.
Yes, apologies are important. But I think that what you said earlier on about the triggering, look, as much as we all want to pretend that we're grown-ups, everyone has no clue what they're doing in life on the whole. We're all winging it until we take our last breath. And because of that, some days we are triggered. And sometimes that can be, like you said, maybe we were about abandoned. Maybe we were bullied. Maybe we were isolated. And you're like, in that moment, you're like, no, I'm not going to be in that position again. I'm superior. I'm better than that. And then, boom, you're acting like you were when you were 12 years old. And having some sympathy and empathy, no matter whether there's a paycheck involved or otherwise, I think it's important. People make mistakes. They're going to fail. We all do. Every single one of us has failed. It's just fortunately most of us haven't failed in a public space with millions of people watching on video.
I think about that most days that's going to happen to me, to be honest. You make a mistake at work, most people, and nobody knows. If you do it,
exactly.
You know, people hear it.
I think the difference with this situation is that universally, even in the rock world, people are going, come on. You know, at the end of the day, if they had Emma felt that way, they would have gone, God, what an arse I made of myself or blah, blah. Well, you know, they're in a position.
Remember,
that
we're on the BBC.
Something.
Come on.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Well, I thought
it's
some stronger words
in the
than
morning.
That, actually.
Oops. Apologies if you're listening and you're offended by that. But that's how easy these things can be. And I mean, we're not comparing that to what happened on the stage, but you know what I mean? It's difficult. And I think Emma's got a point there about this idea of redemption. We're very quick to say, oh, people are, you know, they made a mistake and whatever else. And I'll have done a phone in 3 days before talking about the importance of forgiveness and the importance of, you know, in people's mental health and all the rest of it. And listen, by the way, we could talk about this for the next hour, I feel, but well, I'm running out of time. And just last word, Emma, from you, if you don't mind, about how do we treat people who are going through, if we're someone in our family or someone we know or someone at work is having a wee bit of a moment, having a wee bit of a temper tantrum, what do we do? What's the best way to cope with them?
Always let them run out of steam. You know, the worst thing you can do when somebody's mid-tantrum or having a go at you is to actually try to interject, because we're always trying to think of our own points to put across. Usually that person is in a fever, so they're not going to be able to hear what you're saying. And actually, it's on them to calm down. So I would either say, walk away and just take some space, recalibrate, reevaluate the situation, return when you're in a place where you can speak to them. Or just do what I do. I mean, I've had people I work in the media like you. I've had people shout in my face and be really, really over the top. And I just stop and listen and wait. And then when they've got nothing else to say, I'll tend to say, you know, how are you feeling now and what can I do? What are the solutions that we need to find? And it's amazing how that changes the system of experience with them emotionally. And I think as well, I just think in humanity, we're not perfect. We all can be really nasty and horrible on bad days. And just always, as you said, that word forgiveness and acceptance, and sometimes just realising that what that person is feeling has got nothing to do with you. It's everything to do with them. Don't take it personally, and just allow them a space to kind of unwind and then bring it back to them and challenge them at a time when they're not going to want to bite you. That's probably the best advice.
Right. Brilliant chat. I've really enjoyed this. Thanks so much, Emma. Emma Kenny, their psychologist. Thanks so much to Susie McCabe and thanks to Horse. Just remember what Emma says, we all just need to just take a little step back if this happens today or maybe at some point in the future. It's really good advice. Good to speak to all of you.
You're through to the final of the Scottish Cup. How's that feel?
Oh, it's a huge honour.
Scottish football's oldest prize is at stake.
Celtic take on Inverness Caledonian Thistle.
Celtic are chasing a historic treble.
They will be massive favourites.
We haven't done it yet, but we've given ourselves an opportunity to do something special.
But Inverness Caledonian Thistle have their sights set on lifting the trophy for a second time.
Well, they'll just be turning up and just being underdogs. We'll be hoping to make a game of it.
The Scottish Cup final on Saturday with build-up across the day and the live action from 5:30.
And that's surely the goal that seals the deal!
Watch on BBC One Scotland. Listen on Radio Scotland.
That was good advice, wasn't it, by Emma? Because we've all probably been in that situation either. Whether or not it's you yourself who's having a bit of a tantrum, we've probably all done it, even today. And what to do whenever someone were faced with that, just let them run out of steam and then just ask them how they are. Hopefully you enjoyed that. And by the way, speaking of Radio 1's big weekend, Royal Blood were on just before this guy, who at the moment I am loving everything that he's doing. This is
today. Text 80295. Standard message rates apply.
Mornings on BBC Radio Scotland.
Right, she's back. And I was just saying to you, I don't know if this is inappropriate or not. I was just saying I've got...
Oh, my God. What's coming?
Oh, here we go. Here we
sorry.
Are.
Inappropriate. Do we want to know?
I feel like I've got very motherly feelings towards Lewis Capaldi.
Oh, no, that's allowed. Oh, that's allowed.
It's maybe the hormones, do you think?
Yes. They're kicking in. They're well kicking in.
After
he's
watching,
a wee pet.
I know. After watching his documentary, and I'm like, oh, Lewis, because he's so young and his music's great. I don't know. I think I need to rein that in a wee bit.
No, I don't think you do. And
also,
you start crying.
Well, listen. By the way, I've been there a few times, and Karen's just brought me in a lovely gift for the baby. That was so kind of you. Thank you,
you
so much.
Haven't seen it yet.
I haven't, but I'll rustle it open while you're talking and while we're doing this. That's very much appreciated. Have you been?
I've been fine. I've been away on holiday.
You look great.
To Skye and to Rosemarkie. It was wonderful.
Right.
Yeah, it was lovely.
Do you feel nice and refreshed? And...
No, it was in the camper van, so it's not... It wasn't well camping, but no, I came back and I thought, oh, the weather's even better here. It's lovely in Glasgow, isn't it? I mean, I think it's good across Scotland.
Right, tell me this, and we'll get to actually the important part, which is the conundrum, in just a second. But because in the studio that I'm in Glasgow today, there's not any windows. Well, there's windows through to our lovely people in the gallery, but I can't see outside. Has it changed? Is it
it's
nice now?
33 degrees outside. No, I'm lying. It's cloudy and it's about 13.
Right, okay.
And I'm looking like I'm kind of just coming off the beach. But do you know what? By the time I get out here at 11 o'clock, it's going to be glorious.
Fabulous, right, fingers crossed. Okay, alongside us today is former Agony Aunt and columnist Joan Burney. Morning, Joan.
Morning.
Morning.
I hate camper vans. I think they should be destroyed.
Oh,
morning,
no.
Karen.
Oh,
it's lovely to see you again.
Start.
Or meet you again.
Yes, exactly. Start as we mean to go on, ladies.
The blight, a blight upon the landscape.
Oh, well. Right, well, they can do that for next time, camper vans. But is it nice where you are, Joan?
No, it's actually quite grey, but
I'm
told that the sun is going to shine. Obviously, the sun is going to shine because Karen's around.
Right.
Vacuous laughter.
Do I feel as if I'm going to need a referee's whistle? I feel a sense that might be the case.
I don't know why. Not at all.
Right, okay, let's hear the conundrum.
A few weeks ago, as I went to bring our rubbish bin back in from the street, I noticed a small green bag sitting at the bottom. It was quite clearly dog mess. I couldn't believe someone had the cheek to dirty my newly emptied bin with that. I wouldn't even use someone else's wheelie bin for an empty packet of crisps, let alone this. My husband says surely it's better than being on the street, but that is not the only two options here. I take pride in my clean bin. Now it has happened again, and I want to make a sign warning people not to use my bin for this. My husband says this is crazy, but I'm not going to stand for it. Am I overreacting?
Right, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I should have given a warning before that because we're talking about poo.
And
just
and
in case, just in case anyone's having their a brunch or a late breakfast,
come
or a wee
on,
something.
It's 10 in the morning. Half 10 in the morning.
Or a wee biscuit. Some folk are funny.
Shift workers. Yeah, I suppose they are.
No, but they're like so that can be like a bit of a trigger for some people. They don't like it. Anyway,
right.
Sorry if that is you. Right. So okay, Karen, state your case. Where are you?
Well, I didn't realise this woman was eating out the bin. Her sparkling clean bin. Heavens above, what are bins for but to put rubbish in? I mean, I'm presuming the dog poo wasn't... Sorry, shouldn't be saying that. Was in a bag
the
and
waste.
Not just... The waste was just slapped into it and it went down the side. I mean, hello, this is a rubbish bin. I have absolutely no objection to anyone putting... whatever dog poo, you know, bags into my bin. I would much rather that than, you know, an owner just letting its dog do its business beside the bin and just leaving that. And then you're standing on it in the dark or whatever when you come home. If you want to protect your bin, keep it in your garden. Once it's outside at the roadside, kind of waiting for pickup, then I'm afraid you're on a... Nah.
Right.
You've lost it.
Joan, I mean... Karen's saying that in actual fact it's more important to make sure that we clean up the mess surely off our streets rather than actually having it, rather than, you know, the fact that it's in your bin.
Nothing wrong with that. I mean, I live in fear and trembling of my dog ever disgracing me and doing anything in the street. Every pocket I have is bunged full of bags. But that's the point. If you have a bag, you take it home with you, don't you? I mean, I don't see why you have to pop it into somebody else's bin. Now, I'm not saying that my bins are absolutely sparkling clean, or indeed that I would object. For instance, if the bin was out for the garden waste and somebody dropped a branch into it because, or some, they'd been doing their hedge and they didn't have room in their own bin, fine. Oh. But there's dirty rubbish and there is rubbish, and you do not put your dirty rubbish into anybody else's bin, even if it is out into the street. And in particular, you do not put dog waste out.
Right.
There are, because it's wrong.
Why? Why is it wrong? Sorry, why is it? I missed that bit. Why is it wrong?
Because it's wrong to leave your rubbish,
but
your dog dirt, in anything other than in your own bin if you must, or down your own lab, or dig a hole for it in the garden. I do not care, but you do not leave it out in the street. You do not leave it hanging from a tree, something I've not understood.
Absolutely agree with you there.
But you certainly, most certainly, do not put it in anybody else's bin. There's no reason to. It's in a bag. Some people
are. It's in a bag. That's exactly the point. It's in a bag.
Yeah, it's
bag. Going into
put
a bin.
In bag
end of story.
In your pocket. I mean, listen,
in
there
your
is
pocket. No wait a minute. Some people
have plastic lined pockets into which they put their plastic bags or their
nice
dog food.
Nice hand warmer, I think.
That is horrible, perhaps. But there are. What you must do, of course, first of all, is train your dog not to do anything anywhere.
Don't be ridiculous. It's a dog we're talking about. What kind of controlling person are you?
I have never, ever not had a dog, Karen. And I can say in all seriousness and over my 70-odd years of dog ownership, I have never had my dog deposit something which I would put in somebody else's bin. Actually, my last remaining dog, I have to say, never ever goes outside. He's got a phobia about it. He prefers his own garden. I'm very lucky in that aspect. No, you do not put your dog rubbish into somebody else's bin. End of.
Well, I think you can't really legislate where a dog is going to do its business if you go out for a walk in the park and, you know, you might be.
With you.
Sure, but surely
you get bins in the park.
I was going to say
you get bins in the park. But say you're walking on you're walking from the car, you're walking along a street. So you're not in your own area. You're getting to the end of a long road, and you're about to head into the wilds or whatever. And it's a long street, and your dog does a poo there. I would say you pick it up, and I have to say, I've never done it, but I have absolutely no objection at all to anybody using my bin for stuff like that, for crisp bags, for anything, for poo bags. I have to say, if it was to come to domestic rubbish and they started putting like big things in, yes, I object, but I'd rather people clean the streets and put it in my bin than just walk by it or leave it there.
Joan?
Right, Karen, you become like one of the bins around here which the local council put up, and they say, we accept dog rubbish. That is fine. So you put your poo into that bin. You put a notice like that in your bin, and I'm sure you'll soon find it filled up with everybody's dog rubbish, and good luck to you.
By the way, you know, can I just say this one thing? I'm never really sure about whether or not, like, what one it should go in. If we're talking about from a recycling point of view,
yeah, that's
would
true.
It go in the garden waste because it's like fertilizer?
No, I don't think so. Oh, no? Yeah, no, it would go in the rubbish one.
The waste.
I don't think it's classed as fertilizer, is it?
I don't know. This is a grey area.
I wouldn't want to put it in
the
one for the grey bin.
Think about the bin men. Should they really be going along having to empty?
I don't know, Joan. My bin man must hate me, given the fact I have 100 nappies.
Another
thing. So is it similar?
Yes.
Would you mind someone's nappy?
There's another topic for discussion which you should only use, as I had to use terry toweling ones. Don't use disposables.
That's a topic for another day when I'm sitting in Karen's seat, and then we'll have a conversation about that. Right, okay. Just let wrap this up because we're running out of time. So, Joan, just briefly, quickly state your case again. Where are you?
Well, let me just think. Where is Joan again? Let me just try and get off the fence, Joan.
You do not put your dog's mess into someone else's bin. End of.
80295. Do you agree with Joan, Karen?
Let me think. Yeah. What do you think?
Right, okay. Which way of this debate do you... where do you stand on this? 80295, do you agree with Joan? Do you agree with Karen? Let me know what you think. It is 20-11.
Guiding you through the stories making the news.
This is a community which is obviously in shock.
You can see from here just how vast parts of Scotland are.
News from Scotland, the UK and around the world.
We're likely to see more of these attacks.
The stories that make you smile.
And the final result from my bone marrow tests, and he told me I'd made it.
It's a recipe we've had in the family business for over 40 years.
So the haggis, give us two ingredients.
That would be giving away the secret.
Along with the latest travel, weather and sport.
Wake up to Good Morning Scotland.
Listen to Lunchtime Live from noon.
Head home with Drive Time.
Weekdays on BBC Sounds. It all begins when you play BBC Radio Scotland.
Right, we're going to be talking about the best person to respond to a mental crisis, a mental health crisis.
Work out like a gym kid. Was a girl that I used to hit. You the girl that I gotta quit. See the kitty kid.
Got a girl they like alike. In the night, you're the freak, come out with don't bite. No diggity, who took you out? No doubt, when I first got down, made a bro shout. Look out, make it live, dip and dive, stand alive. Shoot me sugar, there it is. Now we talking, square this. I'm leaving you without a kiss, but I still love a kiss. What you think, I'm him tech. Girl, get your mind checked. Take the time, recollect. I just gave you disrespect.
Like that, meet me 911, baby. Say what, say what. Misdemeanor, 702. What y'all gonna do, fellas? Don't beat them 911.
Get in touch with BBC Radio Scotland.
You can call our free phone number on 08085 92 9500. Text 80295. Standard message rates apply.
This is BBC Radio Scotland.
It's 10:45. It's Connie with you until midday today. We I've got loads of texts actually coming in the court of Karen for obvious reasons. Which side of the fence, if you pardon the pun, do you sit on or stand? Maybe is it okay to put your dog poo in someone else's bin, or should you take it home with you or put it somewhere else? 80295 is the way to get in touch. Now this is a really important conversation that we're about to have. I don't know if you've heard this, but the Metropolitan Police have announced that in less than 100 days, they'll no longer be attending mental health related calls unless they are life threatening, right? The London Force say they have reached breaking point and no longer have the resources to deal with the increasing numbers of calls that they're receiving. Police Scotland say that they've become the first line of response for mental health emergencies in this country, with calls doubling since 2017. Last year alone, the force dealt with over 23,000 mental health related incidents. So I suppose the question with this is, who's actually best to respond when it comes to mental health emergencies? What do we mean by mental health emergencies? We were talking about dementia for the first hour of the programme. We were hearing really distressing situations that people had to deal with that condition. So it's so complex, this, and it's a huge issue and challenge for the police force in this country. So we thought we would talk more about this morning. Here to have that conversation alongside me is David Threadgold, who's chair of the Scottish Police Federation. Morning, David.
Good morning.
Anne Rowan is also founder of the charity Chris's House. Morning, Anne.
Good morning.
Thanks so much for joining us. We've also got Dr. Enoma Akuru, who's a consultant psychiatrist. Morning, Enoma.
Good morning.
And Gary Ritchie, who's the Assistant Chief Constable of Partnership, Prevention and Community Wellbeing at Police Scotland. Morning, Gary.
Good morning.
All right, loads to get through here. So, David, I want to start with your take, first and foremost, on the Met's decision to do this, because it's not necessarily just the Met. This is also, I think there was a scheme started in Humberside, by Humberside Police. It was a trial to see how this worked. And they actually found it worked quite well in terms of improving their resources available. So this is partly why the Met have said, right, OK, for me and for us, this is potentially a way forward. What do you make of it?
Thank you. Firstly, I would like to just say that I do agree with you that this is an incredibly complex area of policing, and I think some context between the difference in the policing principles in Scotland and England are relevant. And without wanting to go into the technical detail of it, if your listeners were minded to search for Section 32 of the Police and Fire Reform Scotland Act of 2012, that will quite simply lay out the principles by which we police in Scotland. What it means in general terms is that it's not as easy as saying that we will not do anything. So we are not saying in Police Scotland that we will never attend any type of emergency call, but the issue that we have in the terms of being able to deliver an effective policing service is what happens once we are there. And it's that piece of work that I believe needs some significant consideration from all parties to allow us to develop a policing model that both satisfies the health aspect of this, but also allows the police to deliver what might be considered core policing duties by your listeners.
Gary, what I think is really important in the first instance with this, right, is how do we define a life-threatening situation. So in this instance with the Met Police, they're talking about the mental health call needs to be a threat to life. How do we assess that when there's an emergency situation? How do we do that quickly enough to make sure that people, vulnerable people, aren't put in more danger?
Well, I think it's a really good question, to me, I agree with you. You know, there's an element of risk there that is put on the shoulders by the person who's receiving that report, as to make that assessment, because, I mean, it might well not appear life-threatening at the start, but we're dealing with somebody who's in mental health distress, so there's a degree of unpredictability about it. But I think David's point, the big point here, and the point of difference, I think, for Police Scotland goes back to what David was saying there. You know, community wellbeing in Scotland for the police has exactly the same prominence as the traditional protection and safety responsibilities that policing has, and that makes us a different service. And I've looked about it, and I think we're the only service in the world that has that degree of prominence and equality between these two elements. So that puts us in a different place to begin with, really. So that point about, you know, making the assessment of whether it's a threat to life is a wee bit irrelevant for us, because if somebody is in mental health crisis and there's nowhere else to go, then the police officers will attend and do their best to help that individual. They might not be the best people, you know, they might not have the training or the capability there, but we're not going to step away from the fact that somebody needs help. And that's the difference here, and that's from the position that the Met's articulated recently.
I think it's important that we get a bit of an understanding of what these calls might look like, and I guess the needs for someone to respond to these calls. And we'll speak to Anne and Dr. Akudu in just a second to get that. But David, I don't know if this is a question for you or for Gary, right? But at the moment, and you can decide between you who's better served to answer this question, but right now, what are we talking about in terms of the amount of time that and resources that is spent right now? David, this is probably maybe best for you. Is spent right now in Scotland. What are we looking at in terms of the amount of resources that are used for mental health cases, and what does that look like right now?
Yeah, I mean, Police Scotland are conducting work to try and, you know, quantify the number of hours, very structured fashion. What I can tell you is the experience of police officers across Scotland at the moment, and in advance of this, I spoke to several across the country to make sure the information I'm about to give you is real. So as an example, if the police are called to a member of the public's home address for whatever reason, that could be comments that they have made or, you know, the information coming in from a third party, we will attend at that person's home address. If, bearing in mind that frontline police officers receive no training in either the clinical diagnosis or establishment of mental health symptoms, they are relying on their own instincts to identify the challenge or the issue that they may believe exists. So the process will then be that we will contact an on-call medical professional. You will then wait anything from between 30 minutes and 5 hours for that call back, all the while sitting within that person's home address. If the diagnosis is that they need to be taken to a hospital facility, then we will take them there, which again in itself is not ideal, to begin the process of triage and further time built into this process for an assessment by a medical professional. If they are admitted to that hospital facility, and that is very much the exception rather than the rule, then our involvement would effectively end. But if it doesn't, which is the vast majority of cases in Scotland, we will then move into the next phase, if you like, of police involvement, which is to find that individual somewhere safe, in inverted commas, for them to go, be it with a family member or friend or neighbour. Now, my information from the officers I've spoken to in the last couple of days is this can take up to 10 hours. Now, it is happening every single day, many times a day, right across Scotland. I can't be more specific than that, but what I can say is that, speaking to a supervisor up in the north of Scotland who had 4 cops come onto their shift, 2 of them were tied up immediately with another investigation and 2 of them were dealing with this. So what you have in effect then is no policing service at all for that area of the country. Now, we are not saying that the police should not initially, or in some circumstances, be the agency that initially attend. But the situation has arisen where we are filling the void almost because of the challenges that exist in health, and the impact on our ability to deliver a policing service is significant when you take into account all of the criticism that the police receive for what it doesn't do.
Okay, I think that's a good point then to bring in Dr. Anoma Okudu. For you, is what David's saying there sort of hitting the nail on the head? Is this more about where there's a lack of resource and there's a gap that needs to be looked at? Because from what David's saying there, it's a case of more mental health professionals are required to make sure that the people who are in need get the services that they require?
It's a really interesting question, and I'm actually really, it's really good to hear experiences from, you know, the side of the police. In my line of work, we work with the police very, very frequently. I'm in communication with police almost every week, mm-hmm. for one reason or the other. So we rely actually a lot on the police for emergency issues and also for more sort of routine things. It is the case that when people are in distress or in some sort of mental health crisis, police will often be the first port of call for people who are dealing with that, so family, friends and relatives, etc. But there are other times when, for example, if I were to go see a patient in their home and I were concerned about the risk they may pose to themselves or others, I would actually ask the police to come with us just in case things escalated. So it's not a very simple answer I can give you.
Yeah.
It just depends on the scenario that we are faced with at the time.
And I want to bring you in. You are the founder of Chris's House, which helps people who are struggling with their own mental health. People that come to you and people that seek help from you are extremely vulnerable, I would imagine. And these are the types of people that will at times have to be accessing these types of services, or maybe friends or relatives or people alongside the people that contact you. What's your experience been, and who do you think the first line of contact should be?
Well, when we're presented with someone in an actual psychotic event, you know, mental health crisis, mm-hmm. that's beyond Chris's House. We're psychotherapists and CBT therapists. We're therapists, but not doctors. Very, very often they need medical intervention. And there's a void. I agree with what's happening with what the police are saying, what David and Gary's saying. The police shouldn't be tied up. They should not be tied up in their full shift on sitting with people, escorting people into A&E, only for these people to be let out and very often die. It's a call that's a very, very difficult call to make. Now, on the withdrawal of the services, it will leave a vacuum. In my eyes, in my opinion, there will be a vacuum. And it's places like Chris's House, the third sector, who are very, very underfunded, we're not funded at all in Chris's House, that are left to pick up the pieces. So there has to be something put in place. I think the 31st of August is way too soon.
And we should say this is the Met Police at the moment. This is what we're talking about right now.
Yes, absolutely. But, you know, it'll follow suit. And in principle, it's a good idea. They can't just leave people to be left alone, wandering, jumping off bridges, jumping in rivers, you know, because
we know that certainly the statistics would tell you that the number of people who are struggling with mental health is increasing right now. Is that your experience, Anna?
Yeah.
Are you seeing more people having to access your service?
People are screaming for help.
We're having some issues again with Anne's line. Omar, are you seeing that from a clinical perspective, the increase in numbers, just briefly?
I think there is a general sense that there is a greater strain on resources. I think with the pandemic and, you know, just life has changed dramatically. I think people are perhaps seeking resources more. I did want to make a point, if it's okay with everybody. You know, in terms of legal powers, police have specific legal powers that allow them to convey people who are in distress or who may be experiencing mental health crisis at the time to places of safety if need be. So I do have concerns that if police were to withdraw their services or not able to show up the way they are now, I wonder how much of an impact that would make. And as Anna said, would leave a huge vacuum. And I'm not sure that we could plug that very easily.
Yeah.
And just wanted to highlight that.
Yeah, no, that's a really important point. Listen, thank you so much. You can hear the music behind me, which means we're coming to the end of this hour. But I appreciate your time. Really important conversation. David Threadgold, Chair of the Scottish Police Federation, Anne Rowan from Chris's House, Dr. Enoma Akudu, Consultant Psychiatrist, and Gary Ritchie, who's Assistant Chief Constable of Partnerships at Police Scotland. Remember, if you've heard anything you'd like some more details or help on, you can go onto the BBC Action Line, bbc.co.uk/actionline.
It's Mornings with me, Connie McLaughlin. How you doing? We were just having a really, really important conversation there about policing when it comes to mental health crisis and emergencies. The Met Police, in 100 days' time, are deciding that they're no longer attending mental health emergencies. And we were discussing what the situation is in this country. I just want to give you a statement from the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government recognises there are significant pressures facing mental health services and the impact that has on other services.
services, including policing. We're working with partners across the health and justice sectors to address these issues, and will continue to invest in wellbeing and prevention alongside intervention and providing mental health services. And by the way, just to reiterate, if you want some advice and support with mental health, that's available to you at bbc.co.uk/actionline. Right, coming up on the programme, you might have heard a little bit earlier, we had the Court of Karen. It's still time to get your messages in. This is the conundrum this week.
I'm furious that my wheelie bin is being used for someone's dog's mess. My husband says I'm overreacting. Am I?
Are they? Text your views, 80295 plus.
Well, I think we simply found your true height. Before years of poor posture and wear and tear crushed your spirit and your spine. Wow!
I'm sitting up a bit straighter now because we're going to be talking about posture. Can you fix it? We'll speak to the expert who might tell us it's never too late. Who knows? That's coming up shortly.
What would you do if you met him now? What would you do?
I haven't got a clue. You know, yeah. Truthfully, I'd probably have a go at him.
And we're talking about feuds as well. That was Roy Keane. He's talking about his feud with Alex Ferguson. It has lasted for years and years and years, but how do you end a decade-long feud?
All the conversations that matter.
Mornings on BBC Radio Scotland.
I don't know, maybe you don't want to. Maybe do we decide it's that point where it's healthy to say, right, OK, it's OK to walk away? Or do you just want to make sure that everything is good with the world? I don't know. This is Addicted to Love, Robert Palmer.
We'll be right back.
Robert Palmer, Addicted to Love. It is 11 minutes after 11, which means it's time to all rise. Court of Karen's back in session, and we're going to hear the verdict on this week's conundrum. This week we were looking at a bit of a controversial topic.
Connie, you didn't rise.
I didn't. Do you want me to? Yeah. Hold on. There you go. I was a wee half rise there because it's a wee bit difficult for me because I've got a big long floaty dress on because it's meant to be nice today. Right, okay. The conundrum was, let's have a reminder of what it was.
A few weeks ago, as I went to bring our rubbish bin back in from the street, I noticed a small green bag sitting at the bottom. It was quite clearly dog mess. I couldn't believe someone had the cheek to dirty my newly emptied bin with that. I wouldn't even use someone else's wheelie bin for an empty packet of crisps, let alone this. My husband says surely it's better than being on the street, but that is not the only two options here. I take pride in my clean bin. Now it has happened again, and I want to make a sign warning people not to use my bin for this. My husband says this is crazy, but I'm not going to stand for it. Am I overreacting?
I think her voice was getting higher and higher. Am I overreacting?
I like the dramatic nature of Steph's voice, who voiced that. Well done to her. I just said a word in my ear from our producer Rory saying you didn't warn about content again there, which is because we were talking about the poo chat and some people are offended.
Oh God,
sorry about that.
Right? Do you have to actually warn?
Sorry, everyone.
Right, if anyone's just having their breakfast now.
But lucky you if you're just having your breakfast at quarter past 11. Right, okay, where are we at? What are people saying?
You can read the
move on.
I think, isn't that so funny? People are very, very precious about their bins. Am I precious about my bin? God, maybe I am. I don't know. Anyway, Pauline says, there isn't a dog owner in Scotland, or probably worldwide, who does not know that they must scoop the... there are plenty public bins marked litter and dog waste. Completely unacceptable to leave dog poo anywhere else. I don't think we're talking about leaving it anywhere else. It's using someone else's bin.
No, I think we're all in agreement that you pick it up. That just goes without saying.
Yes, Shads, use old newspaper if you can't get bags. No, I think that is the point of leaving it in somebody else's bin.
I don't want to go down, but I have used all sorts, trying to improvise in my pockets.
Yeah,
if there's not.
Your nail ever gone through?
No, not quite.
No,
but do you know what? Like, because I'm the same as what Joan was saying earlier. Every pocket, every like bag is just covered.
Yeah, I dare say if I went into my pockets right now, actually,
that's all I've got. It's now poo bags and some sort of baby related paraphernalia.
I know. Gone are the days it was lipstick.
Exactly. Right.
Anne agrees. There are special bins for dog dirt. There are. We're lucky in the city. There are. I don't think there are everywhere, but we certainly are. Lucky in general. Now, JJ in Glasgow, clearly very disappointed with me. Karen, putting dog excrement in my bin is at your peril. Take the thing home and use your own bin. It's your dog's dirt. It's bad etiquette. Dame Joan is right. Sorry, Karen. Well, do you have to say it now? Okay, nobody's going to believe me, right? I have actually never used anyone else's bin. What I was saying is I don't mind if anyone uses my bin. And I have to say as well, when we go out on a walk and Bonnie decides to do her business, whatever, put it in the poo bag, Stephen has been known to walk for, I'd say, a good few miles with his poo bag dangling on the back of his rucksack.
Whacking against his back.
Yeah, I know. And I just have to watch which way the wind's blowing.
I know.
So, I don't use anyone else's. My point is, I don't have any objection to anyone using mine. However, MJ says, on this occasion, I agree with Joan. And so they go on. There are plenty of public dog waste, general waste bins where one can dispose of dog waste. If not, dog walkers should take it home and dispose of it in their own bins. MJ. John's got a great little poem here. Poo conundrum. Pick up the poo with a poly bag and put it in your pee pocket and take it home. Oh no, I thought it was a poem. I agree with Just Joan.
It looked like it was maybe the way it'd been written. It looked like it could have been a little a verse or something.
I think it's because I saw the last one. Take it home. I agree with Just Joan. Oh well, there we are.
Right.
Sam from Glasgow. I have three dogs. One only poos in one spot in park always in 12 years. That's
really?
So funny, isn't it? Yeah. Oh, they've got their habits, haven't they? Mm-hmm. Other two have no preference. Go to Midtown Miami. All people have dogs and no kids. All right. I have never seen a a dog poo. So I also agree with Joan. They definitely train them not to poo in public. The dogs don't even bark.
I don't even know that's
a dog, for God's sake. I think they're on their wind-up.
That's a different kind of dog for another day.
He does say it's the most bizarre thing ever.
Yeah. Right, okay. And we get one final one, an anonymous person saying, bin problem easily solved, fit a chain and padlock and a security camera.
I don't think that's extreme. Yeah, exactly. Bins are bins.
Yeah. I think one thing that we all are in this is agreed that your mess, you deal with it.
It's your responsibility. Take it home or put it in a bin. Okay. There's no one else, anyone else's, according to Joan.
Right,
or
okay. Thank you so much for everyone who's got in touch with us and Karen for coming. And it's so nice to see you.
It's lovely to see you.
I'm going to just open my wee gift now. Thanks very much. I'll see you soon.
Bye.
It kind of feels like the next chapter is opening up.
The BBC Radio Scotland Young Traditional Musician for 2023 is Amy Lawrenson.
Could you be the next winner of this life-changing award? The search for BBC Radio Scotland's Young Traditional Musician 2024 is on.
Being part of it was such a great experience, just spending time with such amazing musicians.
Singers and instrumentalists aged between 16 and 27 have until midnight on Sunday the 25th of June 2023 to apply. For more information, terms, privacy notice and to enter, head to bbc.co.uk/youngtrad.
You're listening to BBC Radio Scotland with me, Connie McLaughlin. It is 17 minutes after 11. Still to come. Is it ever too late to fix your posture? Sorting myself and my chair a wee bit better. Everyone is who's now joined us in the studio. I'll introduce them in just a second. We've got an expert who is on hand to help the lifetime slouchers. That's definitely me. And as the Roy Keane, Alex Ferguson row rears its head again, Sir Alex, how do you end a decade-long feud?
Get in touch with BBC Radio Scotland.
You can call our free phone number on 08085 92 9500. Text 80295. Standard message rates apply.
This is BBC Radio Scotland.
Now, the big racket championship of the summer will be kicking off soon. No. Not Wimbledon, the first Scottish pickleball championship starts this weekend. But if you don't know your shuttlecock from your squash ball, we are joined by two people who know everything about it and can bring us up to speed. I'm joined by Vary Adam, who's the chair of Pickleball Scotland. Morning, Vary.
Morning, thanks for having us.
Thanks so much for coming in. We've got Nanette Murtry, who is the Professor Emerita. Yes?
Emerita.
It was 50-50, wasn't it? the University of Edinburgh. And coaching educational officer at Pickleball Scotland. Right. For as easy as first question of all time, what's pickleball?
Well, it's a bit of a mishmash of table tennis, badminton, tennis. Importantly for Scotland, it's played on a court that's the size of a badminton court. So we've got thousands of them around and about.
Right.
It's a drop net. The whole purpose of the game, we played with a paddle a bit bigger than a table tennis bat, for example.
You've got it in with you.
I have.
Describe it. What's this in front of us? It looks to me like a stop sign, like with a lollipop person might have.
Well, we could customise it. There's two. It's a sort of polymer type paddle with a flat surface, bigger than a table tennis
bat.
Can I have a look?
Let me see. So it's kind of... It's hard, right? And it's almost like a paddle for, like, if you're rowing. That sounds extreme, but you know what I mean.
You could probably row with it.
I think you'd need quite a small boat.
Listen, I could paddle my way out of somewhere.
A canoe, maybe
a wee canoe. And this, it's got quite a short handle.
It has.
So tell us about this ball.
It's played with a plastic airflow ball. Mm-hmm. So that's what it's got a great noise, hasn't it? What the Americans would call a wiffle ball.
Right.
That's an indoor ball that you've got in your hands, and really, it's an indoor game in Scotland because of the weather. That ball's quite light, and there are a few days where the weather wouldn't get in the way. So we play it indoors on badminton courts at schools, leisure centres.
Right, so basically it's a wee plastic ball, about the size of a tennis ball with holes in it.
That's it.
With like kind of rounder holes in it.
Yeah.
Right, okay. I'll give you this back.
One of the joys of it is it's quite a forgiving game to play. The whole game was invented with the idea of all ages being able to participate and the game continuing. Unlike other games. So tennis has this very technical serve that's really problematic. This is just an underarm serve and off you go and start hitting the ball.
Right. And then how did you get involved in this? Because I've never heard of this in my life before.
Oh, well, so a group of my friends used to play squash together. We were all international squash players for Scotland, and we had retired because the game got too hard for us as we were getting into our 50s or 60s. And one of them had been to America and a place called The Villages where pickleball is played a lot. You know, there are hundreds of courts there. And our friend Anna came back with some paddles and said, I think we would like this. After 10 minutes, we were completely hooked because we could use all the skills that we had from our other racket sports, and we got great rallies going. As Vary said, it's not meant to be a game that's finished by an ace serve. It's meant to be a game that the serve can happen underhand, the return has to happen, the returning players have to let that bounce, so you can't volley quickly.
Oh, so it needs to bounce before. Right, can I have a wee shot?
Of course.
Right, this might not work for radio, but we'll do this for a wee second just to see how good I am.
We were wanting to build a court in your reception area. There's loads of space.
Right, come on then, Barry. You can commentate on this, right? Because I'm going off mic a little bit. But right, you ready? Right. So I've got the paddle in my hand. Yeah. So you can hear the ball here.
Yeah.
So
it has got a great noise. This game.
Right, so I've just got to under.
Under. Yeah, under. Yeah. And then it's up on our feet. Good return. Good.
Oh, excellent.
Oh no. It went. We lost the ball. It's gone behind there. Can we get that back?
Only maybe.
Right, okay. But I might have. Do you know this is the equivalent of when your ball goes over the fence to your neighbour and you can't get it back? Wait a minute, we've got a ball girl arriving.
What we were doing there were volleys. Now they can have to happen after the first two bounces have happened. The serve must bounce, the return of serve must bounce, then you can do what we were doing, which was volleys.
One quick one, right?
Oh, another one, right? Another one. We're
just
off.
Just a quickie. Right, okay. I'm very competitive in the net.
Nice and gentle.
So is the net.
Lovely.
Oh, lovely.
Good.
Yes.
Very
is
good.
Is that a point?
That's a point. Yeah, I think you won that.
Right. I think she did, definitely.
Yes. Right, OK. So if people want to take part in pickleball, honestly, I'm really quite pumped for this. I'm like, let's get another game. It's relatively, I'm not going to say it's easy because that's hand-eye coordination is actually more difficult than probably you think
it is. It's very accessible, this game, actually. You can be playing it really quickly. We could get you along to one of our sessions and we'll have you playing the game really happily after about an hour and a half, 2 hours.
I would say 20 minutes.
Yeah. I'm going to say 10. Is that because you've seen how great my skills are?
You are competitive, aren't you?
That's it. We can introduce the game relatively quickly and people can get into a real game without too much technical input from coaching. So older adults, you know, that's where I started. It grew from mostly older adults in Scotland, naturally. But that gives older adults the chance to do an activity that they might not otherwise have done. The racket sports players might hang their rackets up, but no, pickleball lets them get back on the court. The court's smaller. We still get good activity, physical, mental health, social health. It's a really fun social game. But at the other end of the spectrum, you know, I think we can introduce it to children really easily. And this, I think, is a better introduction to racket sports in general than short tennis or badminton, certainly than squash or racquetball or any other game you can come up with, because it's solid. Yeah. And children can direct the ball more easily than rackets with strings in them.
That's exactly what I was going to say, because Rory, our producer, was saying that he was trying to play this with his son a little bit, and he was noticing how you forget how hard that is for young children to get that sort of the motor skills involved in trying to be able to make sure that they can hit the ball, and then you don't want them to feel, oh, I don't want to do this anymore because I can't do it. So is that would you encourage kids to try this?
100%. We would encourage kids to try it. We would encourage PE departments to get in touch with us, because we have the capacity with a 12 lesson plan to give them curriculum in and around pickleball, and they can introduce it into their schools. We're really keen to do that because we want to, we know the future is about teaching children how to play this game. So we really would encourage PE departments get in touch with Pickleball Scotland.
We've got this text in from Neely in Gala Shields. I've started up a local pickleball group in Gala Shields.
Good for you, Neely.
When visiting Los Angeles. It's amazing fun and so inclusive. of Vary Nanetta and all the Pickleball Scotland teams are doing a great job.
Thanks for that.
To a lot of people. What would be the hope then? Where do you want to take this? Is this now that you're thinking about it could be part of Commonwealth Games, Olympics, or is it a case of it doesn't need to be that, it's just enjoyable to play?
I'll give one set of hopes that I have sitting as chair of Pickleball Scotland is that schools, leisure centres will get in touch with us as a consequence of this and they'll begin to introduce pickleball into their centres.
Yeah, and from my perspective in coaching and education, we have two routes that they can follow. We can train people to be ambassadors who are then skilled to introduce the game for the very first time to folk, or we can train people after that to be club coaches, so a little bit more technical and strategic input to the game. But I think it's largely a participation sport, and so that would be our first hope, get more people playing.
Yes.
But once you've done that with this broad, broad base, mm-hmm. inevitably we will rise to the top of a triangle in which it will be an Olympic or Commonwealth sport, because we'll have experts that want to play at the best possible highest competitive level. But let's get the base fixed out first of all, I think.
What if people want to play it?
Well, if they could go onto our website, they'll find a whole list of venues that they can get in touch with, local to them, that would allow them to play. It's pickleballscotland.org if they go onto that. And also, if they just have three other like-minded friends, get in touch with us and we'll come and introduce you to the game, as long as they get a badminton court. So we'll turn
Excellent.
Up.
Excellent.
Yeah, happy to do that.
Well, we've got over 100 ambassadors now in Scotland who might be willing to do that very job.
It might not be me.
Might not be Barry.
Oh, you said it now.
She's quite busy, as it turns out.
People have heard you. Listen, that's so interesting. I really appreciate you coming in and giving me a wee shot of it. It's brilliant.
Good.
And it sounds like something that you know really positive that you're both doing as well. Thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Come along and have a go, though, Colin.
Yeah, I will do. Yeah. You'll regret saying that, though.
Nobody would.
No. There she is again, trying to beat everyone. Right, that was Pickleball. Thanks so much for your time. By the way, this is a new track by Sophie.
Let's go. Let's go. Hey, let's go. Hey.
Could have been dead sleeping in my grave, but you said no, wouldn't have it that way. Gave me a second chance and I thank you for that. The devil tried to get me but you had my back. Lord, you gave your life up just for me. You caused the lame to walk and the blind to see. Could have gave up any day, but you didn't, so all I got to say.
Lord, you've been so good to me. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lord,
as I said, don't forget she is on the afternoon show today. Before that, though, it's Lunchtime Live, which is after me, 12, if you're still following. taking you through to the afternoon show is Lucy White. Morning.
Good morning. It's Hayley and Miller and I today. And let's just let everyone know, I've been running to the studio. That's why I sound out of breath.
I thought you did that with extreme grace. You flew in there like a bat out of hell with flip-flops on.
Just so busy. Yeah, flip-flops and running don't go together. I'm just so busy getting the programme together. So sorry to everyone here, that was a bit late.
No, but also it's like, it's one of those things where you do that, you think, oh yes, I've made it on time. But then you realise you can't breathe.
And you need to speak out loud.
They don't go together. Not so much.
Let me tell you what's on the programme though from 12am, myself and Hayley Miller. So there's a report which has come out which says that Police Scotland officers, if they raise concerns about sexism and misogyny, that they feel that they've then got a target on their back. And of course it comes, you'll have heard the news last week from the outgoing chief constable of the force, which said it was institutionally racist and discriminatory. So we're going to be talking about that today, about the culture within Police Scotland, and speaking to people who have worked there before. We're also going to be speaking to the charity which runs hospices in Scotland, and they are really worried about their funding. They say they're struggling to meet their energy bills and also to keep up with pay rises that people that work for them are being offered elsewhere in the NHS. And also, Connie, if you had a spare £30,000, I can see you living in a castle in Shetland.
I could.
£30,000.
It would be quite the commute.
It would be a bit of a commute. I don't know what you'd do with your family. Mm-hmm. So we're going to be talking about this castle that's up for sale. There is
Can I take them with me? Is that what we're saying?
They could go. There is potentially a £12 million sting in the tail, though. So listen to find out what that's all about.
I know the answer to this question, right, because I know you well.
Yes.
Right? And you,
I'm so scared about what you're going to ask me now.
Your posture's good. You've always actually got quite good.
Do you
good,
think so?
I do think you've got good posture. So do you not think so?
I've never really thought about it, but maybe that means I do. I've not got a sore back or anything like that.
My posture is horrendous, right? It's really bad, which for our next item, I think is one of these ones where I'm trying to pretend that I'm actually better than I am, sitting up a wee bit straighter in my chair, because we're talking about being hunched over your desk and this idea of making sure that you are in the correct position for the rest of the day. So you maybe want to listen into this.
I will do. Well, lots of our fellow presenters, they stand up for their whole programme.
Kay likes to stand up.
I'm too lazy to do that, but maybe that's the way forward.
I also feel as if I'm standing up quite a lot of the rest of the day.
This is a nice chance for a wee seat.
This is good for me. Right, okay, Lucy, thanks for that. We'll hear from you more at 12 o'clock today. We are talking now about posture, because do you spend most of your day hunched over a desk, or like kind of like me today, or are you sitting in the car for hours at a time, also kind of like me? Either of those could be wreaking havoc on your posture, and maybe you've been doing this for years, months. So is it ever too late, though, to try and save your posture, and could it improve your overall health? Here to talk to me more about this is a freelance radio presenter and self-confessed sloucher, Daniela Gualtieri. Is that the right pronunciation?
Gualtieri.
Yeah. I know there. And chiropractor Catherine Quinn. Morning to both of you.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Thanks so much for coming on. Right, Daniela, first of all, I'm looking at you now. Your posture's not too bad.
I mean, I think, like you're saying, it's the self-conscious because we're having this conversation. I'm shoulders back, chin rested, like looking forward. But on a day-to-day basis, like you're saying, if you're over a desk or you're driving, or not even for me, I've got my phone out all the time as well. So your head down, scrolling, and it goes to pot.
Catherine, how should we be sitting? Because if I'm trying to correct my posture, right, I know I've got rounded shoulders or too far over the front. But sometimes I think, is that to do more with the fact that maybe you're not strong, your back's not as strong as it could be?
Well, you've hit all the key points there. I think the really important thing to start with is to note that one posture is not right for everybody.
Right.
It's not a one-size-fits-all. And actually, there's no evidence to suggest that bad posture that we all consider, you know, the rounded shoulders, etc., is actually the thing that causes things like back and neck pain.
Okay.
What the evidence suggests is that actually it's the inactivity that goes with that that's the problem. So it's being in that one position for a long time, but that posture might be different for each person. So what I often advise my patients to look at is that they have mobile postures, you know, have scheduled times to stand, to walk around the room, you know, if you're on a phone call or on a meeting where you can be upright, do that, you know, put your headphones in and have a little walk around or stand up at your desk. But there's no one size that fits everybody. But if you are linking certain positions to pain for you individually, then there's lots of simple stretches and techniques that you can use during the day to help you.
Okay, give us an example of them.
So there's some really simple tips. So, for example, as I say, the inactivity being one of the leading causes of the back pain and neck pain we get when we're in those positions, have you scheduled in standing times? So use technology to help you with this. If you've got an Apple Watch, it will tell you every hour to stand up and move around. You can use that as your signal. And there are some simple stretches you can do, such as linking your fingers behind your back and stretching those back and down. So you're squeezing your shoulder blades together and getting a nice stretch through the front of the shoulders. One of my favourites is what I call the corkscrew exercise, where you link your fingers on the back of your head gently, open out the elbows, and then shrug your shoulders up.
I'm just looking at every single person in the studio and in our gallery is doing the same thing as well. So we're all right.
Brilliant.
So wait a minute. Hands behind, hands linked.
Keep each other to account. Yeah.
And
so
behind.
That's lovely.
And you move just round side to side.
That's it. So you can go up and down with the shoulder blades. So that will get that moving. And you'll find it might feel a bit clunky to begin with.
Yeah.
But you'll find that that really frees up when you start doing this regularly.
Yeah.
And then if you really want to go for it, you can add in what's called the teapot move. So in that same shoulders back, hands on the head position, go from side to side. Just
That's a bit more.
Feeling loose.
Yeah, I'm feeling a bit tight in the back.
Where you feel your tension, yeah. So you might find it more to the sides, and then that's where the teapot movement will come in handy. So there's some really simple ones. But even if that's not neck pain that's your problem, if it's more your lower back, you can firstly think about, right, sitting your bottom right back into the chair so you're a little bit more upright. But you could also try things like knee-to-chest hugs in the chair, or if you've got some space, get on the floor and pop a yoga mat down, and you could use that.
I'll do that during this one. Don't mind me, everyone. I've already done my exercise today, my pickleball earlier on, so I'm all right.
So you can do them from your seat if you need to.
Right.
So your knee-to-chest, hugging those in. But, you know, the combination of using those upper back and those lower back stretches will help you quite broadly, and I'd suggest doing both.
Right. Daniela, you're like me because you sit for long periods in front of a microphone. It can be hard because, I mean, so if I'm doing this show, it's 3 hours and you're sitting, you're moving about, but you're not trying to, you can't go anywhere.
Yeah, and you're trying to, all your focus is towards your computers and your mics and all the stuff that you're using, so you're kind of putting all your attention and your weight, I suppose, in one direction.
How do you try and combat that? Are you aware of it?
Yes and no. I mean, you catch yourself doing it. Like you're saying, if you're sitting in one position for so long, you might be go, oh, I need a wee stretch. And you physically need a moment to kind of go the opposite way of how much you've been hunching your body over. But I mean, I just do love to lounge. I know that the point here is to get moving. But if I'm not sitting doing my work all day, then you go home and you want to either lie back on the sofa, on your bed, on the couch. But I've just always got my phone in my face as well, which is, I think, what the problem is as well. So if you're not working, then yeah, I'm just lounging. So it probably is just get up and get moving.
Do you catch yourself?
Yes, sometimes.
I think it's like pictures. Sometimes I see in pictures, I'm like, oh my. Or if you're doing stuff on screen or whatever, I'm like, oh my goodness. Stand up straight.
If you catch, your eye catches it, and that's it. If you're out for dinner as well, like my nonna's probably the only person who would correct me, like, you sit up straight, you, that's enough. And then you go, right, nonna, yes, okay. You do it for 5 minutes and you just feel yourself slowly slumping back down to your natural position.
Is there supports, Catherine, that you can get in the meantime? You know, sort of back supports or things to hold you in?
These things are all on the market, but what I would really encourage people to do is to avoid using those sorts of braces, particularly for day-to-day activity. With my patient groups, you know, I've got people who work in different trades, you know, scaffolders, builders, some of my beauty therapists, hairdressers.
Yeah, leaning all the time.
So those people, if it's something that they really struggle with, I would say use it for a part of the day. You know, use it for a little bit of the day, maybe when you're getting a bit tired or if you're doing a particularly heavy part of your shift, then you could use those braces short term. But actually, you've got an inbuilt set of muscles that do exactly the job of that brace. And if you only use a external brace to hold that position, as soon as you take it off, you've not built up any strength in the muscles that can do it for you. Yeah, and so it can actually become more difficult to then build that. You know, people don't need to be spending hours and hours at the gym necessarily to make some strength changes to those areas. You can use kit at home. You can use some like simple weights that, you know, you don't need to pay anything for, you know, like a bottle of water. That can be a nice little weight. So just start building up some strength in those upper back muscles. And it's the rowing type exercises. So, you know, the bent over row where you're kind of slightly lent forwards. Be careful to keep your spine nice and neutral when you're doing that. And squeezing the shoulder blades back, pulling the weight up towards your chest, building those muscles at the back of your shoulder. That will help you to hold those positions for longer and feel a little bit more comfortable doing it.
Right. Has that inspired you, Daniela?
Definitely need to get the water bottles at the ready, go home, get them filled up and get working out.
Although given the size of the water bottle that I've got there, good luck with it. I carry that about with me. I've got a 2-litre bottle of water that I carry about with me, so I pretend that I'm drinking loads of water.
Keeping healthy.
And all that serves is just that I need to go to the loo every 2 minutes. Just a bit annoying. Right, listen, thank you so much for that, Catherine, who's a chiropractor. That was really, really interesting and also hopefully helpful to you listening at home and for you, Daniela, as well.
Definitely.
Good to see you. Right, OK, it is 11:43.
Now you can own one of the greatest gospel albums ever offered. With only giant hits and legendary stars like Aretha Franklin. Jesus. They're all here in a special TV collection called Rough Side of the Mountain. Watch carefully. You get Al Green's most exciting gospel hit.
Like you said you would. I feel like praise.
Shirley Caesar's Hold My Mule, her story song of thanks and praise. The Winans. The Clark Sisters, You Brought the Sunshine. The Thompson Community Choir. Inspiring hits and stars like Thomas Whitfield, Inez Andrews, Marion Williams, and James Cleveland. This album is not sold in stores. Order by calling this toll-free number now, and you'll also get another Rough Side Treasury with the New Jersey Mass Choir, the Angelics, Gospel Greats of the Past,
Judge me, Lord,
Sam Cooke, Brother Joe May, Alex Bradford. Remember, call now and hear the sermon that's sweeping America. Watch Them Dogs.
Who in the hell left the gate open?
Sonja Crouch. Write this toll-free number down and call now. Get both Rough Side of the Mountain Treasuries, only $14.98. And on all record and tape sets, we include the man who knows about rough side climbing, it's Reverend time. Jesse Jackson's most inspiring sermon.
It's moment time.
Call now for Rough Side of the Mountain.
Right, tomorrow on the programme, Stephen is back. Dr. Poonam returns for this week's general health surgery. Any questions that you've got, maybe something that you're thinking, I'm not really quite sure, I don't really want to bother the doctor with it, but you think I'd quite like to get to the bottom of it, you can get your questions in early. You can email us actually at kaye@bbc.co.uk. You can do that now and you can give her a text or give her a phone tomorrow. We'll be joined by Susan Douglas-Scott, CBE, to find out why this year's Pride event is more important than ever. Plus, one major online retailer offers term time contracts to employers. He's asking whether or not companies should follow suit. Is that something that should happen? All that and much, much more chat with Stephen tomorrow morning from 9 on BBC Radio Scotland. This is Once in a Lifetime.
And you may find yourself living in a shotgun shack, and you may find yourself in another part. Behind the wheel of a large automobile, and you may find yourself in a beautiful house with a beautiful wife, and you may ask yourself, well, how did I get here?
Let it go.
same as it ever was, 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 same as it ever was. Water dissolving and water removing. There is water at the bottom of the ocean. Under the water, carry the water.
Catch up on the conversation. Listen via the BBC Sounds app.
Mornings on BBC Radio Scotland.
We're going to be talking about how you end a feud in just a couple of minutes' time, right? But we were talking earlier on about adult tantrums, remember, earlier in the programme? Or if you don't remember because you're just joining us, we were talking about Royal Blood, who are a band who had a bit of an incident on the stage on Sunday, Radio 1's Big Weekend, and they had a bit of an issue with the crowd. John from Kilmarnock's been on to say, Royal Blood aren't a new band. Agents should never have booked them on Radio 1's show, which is actually for wee girls. And this anonymous texter says, kind of similar theme, excuse me, I'm a fan of heavy metal music, music of the heaviest kind, but I dabble in all sorts of different things. It occurs to me that Royal Blood, who are a big band, may have gotten into their own heads, knowing that they are about to play to an audience who likely aren't really that familiar with their material. They simply went into it with a completely wrong attitude. And by the way, as a side point, someone said earlier they don't know who Royal Blood are, but quite honestly, I didn't know who Niall Horan is. Different strokes for different folks. So that makes a lot of sense. Thanks so much for getting in touch. 80295 is the way to do it. You've got about 10 minutes left before the end of the programme if you want to have your say on that. Different strokes for different folks is probably a good way to describe it. Now, often friends fall out, and all is well, it's after a couple of days, or maybe it's your family or whatever else, and you can sort it out. But sometimes a fallout can become a feud. Right, and a feud can go on for a very long time. It'd be quite interesting to see that that's probably what the difference is between a wee falling out and a feud. Now, Roy Keane, who you might remember from his Manchester United days, or now as a pretty important and well-known, I think that's a better phrase, pundit on football, and Sir Alex Ferguson, they two were really, really close to each other. He was Roy Keane was his most trusted midfielder at one point and captain as well at Manchester United for over a decade. But the relationship has never quite recovered after his stormy exit, Roy Keane, that is, from the club back in 2005. If you're a fan of football, you'll probably remember this. And with Roy Keane still having a little dig at his former mentor this week, we were wondering how on earth you can end a feud that's lasted that long, especially one that's been brewing for over 20 years. Join me to talk more about this is Dr. Rachel Taylor, who's a neuropsychologist and human behaviour expert. Morning, Rachel.
Good morning.
And also on the line is Stuart Weir, who's an author and broadcaster. Morning, Stuart.
Good morning.
Right, Rachel, what do you mean? What's the difference between a feud and a falling out?
Well, a falling out is basically just when you have like sort of a disagreement on on anything really, but it's not deep enough to cause massive wounds, and generally, you know, an apology or talking about it can sort it out. A feud is when something is so upsetting on a very deep level, normally an identity level, that it challenges people on who they are and what they stand for. Generally, a feud is when people don't want to give up that part of their belief or identity, you know, to sort of reconcile.
Does it depend on the people? Because I mean, I don't know these characters. I know the persona that they give out to the general public, which would be two very strong characters in Roy Keane and Sir Alex Ferguson. So can it sometimes just be not necessarily about your core sort of values? It can be about personality as well, and this idea of, well, I don't want to look to be weak by giving up.
But that is one of your core values. Your core values make up who you are and how you present yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, and this is what is really important, is that often, unless you really think about what your values are, you inherit a set of values from, you know, whoever has influenced you growing up and what your influences are.
I think maybe, you know, what I'm getting at then more with that is more about ego. Because surely that's not part of the core of who you are. If it's,
of course it is. Yeah. Ego is part of who. Yeah. And this is the thing about ego, is that it's very much as part of your identity and your values and who you are. And as
is it not
else.
Protecting part of that?
Well, the ego is something that we need to respect, because if it's the way it is, it's because of influences, it's because of experiences, it's because of beliefs, it's because of what you think. And it's not as simple to say, oh, it's an ego thing, because...
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Yeah, ego is part of who you are. Now, your ego might be extremely protective of yourself, or your ego might not care about other people trampling all over your boundaries. Yeah. You know, it's entirely dependent on how you view yourself within a relationship.
And that's kind of, I suppose, what I'm getting at with this, because sure, yeah, these two characters are known for being very strong types of characters. What did you make of this in the first instance? This, I was going to say tiff, but I think it's more than a tiff between Roy Keane and Sir Alex Ferguson.
I think this is a kind of annual event, actually, that Roy, every now and again, you know, just comes out and basically launches into a tirade at Sir Alex Ferguson, who I can see, you know, maybe sitting at home watching the horse racing and sipping another glass of red wine, thinking to himself, there's Roy at it again, and not really caring very much about it. I think ultimately what happens with some of these feuds or tiffs or whatever you want to describe it, I think these two guys are driven by the same thing. They want to excel. They want to be the best. They want to be winners. They're out-and-out winners. And they might not always have taken the same path, but ultimately, they get the job done. I think how they get the job done, that's where there might be a breakdown in the kind of communications. And as much as Sir Alex Ferguson was the boss and would do it his way, Roy Keane certainly did things his own way, but ultimately one guy had ultimate power, and that was Sir Alex. And as you rightly said there, going back to 2005 and the unceremonious way that Roy Keane was dumped from United, mm-hmm, I think that's obviously irked him, you know, for the last 18 years, and probably actually, dare I say it, long before that. But again, as a footballer, he wanted to win and wanted to succeed, and the best way of doing that was with Sir Alex Ferguson at the helm.
Rachel, and you maybe touched on it a wee bit earlier on, actually, and what Stuart's saying there is just kind of is making me think. Is this down to an feud in general? Because we don't know the ins and outs of that one in particular, but I'm just thinking about it more generally. When one person feels wounded, or both parties feel wounded, and this is the way that we try and keep ourselves safe from it by just keeping a distance, because it's just too hurtful if we've got to actually face it.
Yeah, exactly. Unless you're going to sort it out, then that is, you know, it's a defensive stance. But I would, you know, want to say that, you know, 20 years down the line, it's more than a protectionism. You know, if somebody feels, you know, and possibly both still feel aggrieved, if this is an annual event, then this is not protectionism. This is, I'm still here and I'm still proving a point. So nobody has reconciled anything here. nothing whatsoever.
When it gets to that point and you're so far down the line, say it's 20 years, say it's whatever, and I guess these things can be quite prevalent in families that sometimes so much time goes by that it's almost like it's kind of gone too far down the line now that you think it can never be sorted out. Can these things recover, Rachel?
Yeah, of course they can. If both people want to, reconcile and they want to, have a relationship going forward, of course it can be done. But one thing is for sure, it can never be the same as it was before, because that was the perfect environment for actually the feud, the tiff, whatever, actually occurring. So both people have to really, what do I want from this relationship and why do I want to be part of this person's life again?
Okay, so interesting. Just briefly, a couple of words, Stuart. Should they do it? Should they make amends?
No.
Stuart.
For one, we wouldn't get invited on radio programme to talk about it.
That's true. By the way, it's really what a topic this is, because we could talk and talk about this. It's been brilliant to speak to both of you. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
I doubt, just on the next song, I doubt this feels so good. This is Sonic, It Feels So Good. Diffuse.
You always make me smile when I'm feeling down. You give me such a vibe, I just totally bona fide. It's not the way you walk, and it ain't the way you talk. You got that keeps me satisfied. You love me.
And it feels so good. Thanks so much to everyone who's been in touch with us today. I got this lovely text in saying, from Dini saying, I want to let you know my husband had just started listening to the phone in this morning. He usually switches over. Thankfully he didn't. He stayed listening. Very effective calls and affecting him. She said, I was quite moved and I'm really moving out of radio. I'm going to go back and listen back to it. We're now 61 and 69 and it's got us thinking. Thank you so much for getting in touch, Dini. Thanks to everyone who has been part of the programme today. I'm back soon. Stephen's back tomorrow. It's time to hand you over now to Lunchtime Live this morning with Lucy White and Hayley Miller.
Thank you so much, Connie. Thank you.